Homilies and Recognitions by Bishop Clement. Continues. Homilies. Book 7. Chapter 1. Peter addresses the people. And on the fourth day of our stay in Tyre, Peter went out about daybreak, and there met him not a few of the dwellers round about, with very many of the inhabitants of Tyre itself, who cried out, and said, God through you have mercy upon us, God through you heal us. And Peter stood on a high stone, that all might see him, and having greeted them in a godly manner, thus began. Chapter 2. Reason of Simon's power. God, who created the heavens and the whole universe, does not want occasion for the salvation of those who would be saved. Wherefore let no one, in seeming evils, rashly charge him with unkindness to man. For men do not know the issue of those things which happen to them, nay, suspect that the result will be evil, but God knows that they will turn out well. So is it in the case of Simon. He is a power of the left hand of God, and has authority to do harm to those who know not God, so that he has been able to involve you in diseases, but by these very diseases, which have been permitted to come upon you by the good providence of God, you, seeking and finding him who is able to cure, have been compelled to submit to the will of God on the occasion of the cure of the body, and to think of believing, in order that in this way you may have your souls as well as your bodies in a healthy state. Chapter 3. The Remedy. Now I have been told, that after he had sacrificed an ox he feasted you in the middle of the forum, and that you, being carried away with much wine, made friends with not only the evil demons, but their prince also, and that in this way the most of you were seized by these sicknesses, unwittingly drawing upon yourselves with your own hands the sword of destruction. For the demons would never have had power over you, had not you first supped with their prince. For thus from the beginning was a law laid by God, the creator of all things, on each of the two princes, him of the right hand and him of the left, that neither should have power over anyone whom they might wish to benefit or to hurt, unless first he had sat down at the same table with them. As, then, when you partook of meat offered to idols, you became servants to the prince of evil, in like manner, if you cease from these things, and flee for refuge to God through the good prince of his right hand, honoring him without sacrifices, by doing whatsoever he wills, know of a truth that not only will your bodies be healed, but your souls also will become healthy. For he only, destroying with his left hand, can quicken with his right, he only can both smite and raise the fallen. Chapter 4. The Golden Rule. Wherefore, as then ye were deceived by the forerunner Simon, and so became dead in your souls to God, and were smitten in your bodies, so now, if you repent, as I said, and submit to those things which are well pleasing to God, you may get new strength to your bodies, and recover your soul's health. And the things which are well pleasing to God are these: to pray to him, to ask from him, recognizing that he is the giver of all things, and gives with discriminating law, to abstain from the table of devils, not to taste dead flesh, not to touch blood, to be washed from all pollution, and the rest in one word, as the God-fearing Jews have heard, do you also hear, and be of one mind in many bodies, let each man be minded to do to his neighbor those good things he wishes for himself. And you may all find out what is good, by holding some such conversation as the following with yourselves: you would not like to be murdered, do not murder another man; you would not like your wife to be seduced by another, do not you commit adultery; you would not like any of your things to be stolen from you, steal nothing from another. And so understanding by yourselves what is reasonable, and doing it, you will become dear to God, and will obtain healing; otherwise in the life which now is your bodies will be tormented, and in that which is to come your souls will be punished. Chapter 5. Peter departs for Sidon. After Peter had spent a few days in teaching them in this way, and in healing them, they were baptized. And after that, all sat down together in the marketplaces in sackcloth and ashes, grieving because of his other wondrous works, and repenting their former sins. And when they of Sidon heard it, they did likewise, and sent to beseech Peter, since they could not come themselves for their diseases. And Peter did not spend many days in Tyre, but when he had instructed all its inhabitants, and freed them from all manners of diseases and had rounded a church, and set over it as bishop one of the elders who were with him, he departed for Sidon. But when Simon heard that Peter was coming, he straightway fled to Beerout with Appian and his friends. Chapter 6. Peter in Sidon. And as Peter entered Sidon, they brought many in couches, and laid them before him. And he said to them, Think not, I pray you, that I can do anything to heal you, who am a mortal man, myself subject to many evils. But I shall not refuse to show you the way in which you must be saved. For I have learned from the prophet of truth the conditions foreordained of God before the foundation of the world, that is to say, the evil deeds which if men do he has ordained that they shall be injured by the prince of evil, and in like manner the good deeds for which he has decreed that they who have believed in him as their physician shall have their bodies made whole, and their souls established in safety. Chapter 7. The Two Paths. Knowing, then, these good and evil deeds, I make known unto you as it were two paths, and I shall show you by which travelers are lost and by which they are saved, being guided of God. The path of the lost, then, is broad and very smooth, it ruins them without troubling them, but the path of the saved is narrow, rugged, and in the end it saves, not without much toil, those who have journeyed through it. And these two paths are presided over by unbelief and faith, and these journey through the path of unbelief, those who have preferred pleasure, on account of which they have forgotten the day of judgment, doing that which is not pleasing to God, and not caring to save their souls by the word, and have not anxiously sought their own good. Truly they know not that the counsels of God are not like men's counsels, for, in the first place, he knows the thoughts of all men, and all must give an account not only of their actions, but also of their thoughts. And their sin is much less who strive to understand well and fall, than that of those who do not at all strive after good things. Because it has pleased God that he who errs in his knowledge of good, as men count errors, should be saved after being slightly punished. But they who have taken no care at all to know the better way, even though they may have done countless other good deeds, if they have not stood in the service he has himself appointed, come under the charge of indifference, and are severely punished, and utterly destroyed. Chapter 8. The service of God's appointment. And this is the service he has appointed, to worship him only, and trust only in the prophet of truth, and to be baptized for the remission of sins, and thus by this pure baptism to be born again unto God by saving water, to abstain from the table of devils, that is, from food offered to idols, from dead carcasses, from animals which have been suffocated or caught by wild beasts, and from blood, not to live any longer impurely, to wash after intercourse, that the women on their part should keep the law of purification, that all should be sober-minded, given to good works, refraining from wrongdoing, looking for eternal life from the all-powerful God, and asking with prayer and continual supplication that they may win it. Such was Peter's counsel to the men of Sidon also. And in few days many repented and believed, and were healed. And Peter having founded a church, and set over it as bishop one of the elders who were with him, left Sidon. Chapter 9. Simon attacks Peter. No sooner had he reached Beerout than an earthquake took place, and the multitude, running to Peter, said, Help us, for we are afraid we shall all utterly perish. Then Simon ventured, along with Appian and Anubian and Athenodorus, and the rest of his companions, to cry out to the people against Peter in public, Flee, friends, from this man, he is a magician, trust us, he it was who caused this earthquake, he sent us these diseases to terrify us, as if he were God himself. And many such false charges did Simon and his friends bring against Peter, as one who could do things above human power. But as soon as the people gave him a moment's quiet, Peter with surprising boldness gave a little laugh, and said, Friends, I admit that I can do, God willing, what these men say, and more than that, I am ready, if you do not believe what I say, to overturn your city from top to bottom. Chapter 10. Simon is driven away. And the people were afraid, and promised to do whatever he should command. Let none of you, then, said Peter, either hold conversation with these sorcerers, or have anything to do with them. And as soon as the people heard this concise command, they took up sticks, and pursued them till they had driven them wholly out of the town. And they who were sick and possessed with devils came and cast themselves at Peter's feet. And he seeing all this, and anxious to free them from their terror, said to them. Chapter 11. The Way of Salvation. Were I able to cause earthquakes, and do all that I wish, I assure you I would not destroy Simon and his friends, but would make him my friend, that he might no longer, by his slanders against my teaching the truth, hinder the salvation of many. But if you believe me, he himself is a magician, he is a slanderer, he is a minister of evil to them who know not the truth. Therefore he has power to bring diseases on sinners, having the sinners themselves to help him in his power over them. But I am a servant of God the Creator of all things, and a disciple of his prophet who is at his right hand. Wherefore I, being his apostle, preach the truth, to serve a good man I drive away diseases, for I am his second messenger, since first the disease comes, but after that the healing. By that evil working magician, then, you were stricken with disease because you revolted from God. By me, if you believe on him ye shall be cured, and so having had experience that he is able, you may turn to good works, and have your souls saved. Chapter 12. Peter goes to Byblos and Tripolis. As he said these things, all fell on their knees before his feet. And he, lifting up his hands to heaven, prayed to God, and healed them all by his simple prayer alone. And he remained not many days in Beerout, but after he had accustomed many to the service of the one God, and had baptized them, and had set over them a bishop from the elders who were with him, he went to Byblos. And when he came there, and learned that Simon had not waited for them for a day, but had gone straightway to Tripolis, he remained there only a few days, and after that he had healed not a few, and exercised them in the scriptures, he followed in Simon's track to Tripolis, preferring to pursue him rather than flee from him. Book 8. Chapter 1. Peter's arrival at Tripolis. Now, as Peter was entering Tripolis, the people from Tyre and Sidon, Berytus and Byblos, who were eager to get instruction, and many from the neighborhood, entered along with him, and not least were there gatherings of the multitudes from the city itself wishing to see him. Therefore there met with us in the suburbs the brethren who had been sent forth by him to ascertain as well other particulars respecting the city, as the proceedings of Simon, and to come and explain them. They received him, and conducted him to the house of Maroons. Chapter 2. Peter's thoughtfulness. But he, when he was at the very gate of his lodging, turned round and promised to the multitudes that after the next day he would converse with them on the subject of religion. And when he had gone in, the forerunners assigned lodgings to those who had come with him. And the hosts and the entertainers did not fall short of the desire of those who sought hospitality. But Peter, knowing nothing of this, being asked by us to partake of food, said that he would not himself partake until those who had come with him were settled. And on our assuring him that this was already done, all having received them eagerly by reason of their affection towards him, so that those were grieved beyond measure who had no guests to entertain. Peter hearing this, and being pleased with their eager philanthropy, blessed them and went out, and having bathed in the sea, partook of food with the forerunners, and then, the evening having come, he slept. Chapter 3. A conversation interrupted. But awaking about the second cock crowing, he found us astir. We were in all 16, namely, Peter himself, and I, Clement, Nistus and Aquila, and the 12 who had preceded us. Having therefore saluted us, he said, Today, not being occupied with those without, we are free to be occupied with one another. Wherefore I shall tell you the things that happened after your departure from Tyre, and do you minutely relate to me what have been the doings of Simon here. While, therefore, we were answering one another by narratives on either side, one of our friends entered, and announced to Peter that Simon, learning of his arrival, had set off for Syria, and that the multitudes, thinking this one night to be like a year's time, and not able to wait for the appointment which he had made, were standing before the doors conversing with one another in knots and circles about the accusation brought by Simon, and how that, having raised their expectations, and promised that he would charge Peter when he came with many evils, he had fled by night when he knew of his arrival. However, said he, they are eager to hear you, and I know not whence some rumor has reached them to the effect that you are going to address them today. In order, therefore, that they may not when they are very tired be dismissed without reason, you yourself know what it is proper for you to do. Chapter 4. Many called. Then Peter, wondering at the eagerness of the multitudes, answered, You see, brethren, how the words of our Lord are manifestly fulfilled. For I remember his saying, Many shall come from the east and from the west, the north and the south, and shall recline on the bosoms of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. But many, said he also, are called, but few chosen. The coming, therefore, of these called ones is fulfilled. But inasmuch as it is not of themselves, but of God who has called them and caused them to come, on this account alone they have no reward, since it is not of themselves but of him who has wrought in them. But if, after being called, they do things that are excellent, for this is of themselves, then for this they shall have a reward. Chapter 5. Faith the gift of God. For even the Hebrews who believe Moses, and do not observe the things spoken by him, are not saved, unless they observe the things that were spoken to them. For their believing Moses was not of their own will, but of God, who said to Moses, Behold, I come to thee in a pillar of cloud, that the people may hear me speaking to thee, and may believe thee forever. Since, therefore, both to the Hebrews and to those who are called from the Gentiles, believing in the teachers of truth is of God, while excellent actions are left to every one to do by his own judgment, the reward is righteously bestowed upon those who do well. For there would have been no need of Moses, or of the coming of Jesus, if of themselves they would have understood what is reasonable. Neither is there salvation in believing in teachers and calling them lords. Chapter 6. Concealment and Revelation. For on this account Jesus is concealed from the Jews, who have taken Moses as their teacher, and Moses is hidden from those who have believed Jesus. For, there being one teaching by both, God accepts him who has believed either of these. But believing a teacher is for the sake of doing the things spoken by God. And that this is so our Lord himself says, I thank thee, Father of heaven and earth, because thou hast concealed these things from the wise and elder, and hast revealed them to sucking babes. Thus God himself has concealed a teacher from some, as foreknowing what they ought to do, and has revealed him to others, who are ignorant what they ought to do. Chapter 7. Moses and Christ. Neither, therefore, are the Hebrews condemned on account of their ignorance of Jesus, by reason of him who has concealed him, if, doing the things commanded by Moses, they do not hate him whom they do not know. Neither are those from among the Gentiles condemned, who know not Moses on account of him who hath concealed him, provided that these also, doing the things spoken by Jesus, do not hate him whom they do not know. And some will not be profited by calling the teachers lords, but not doing the works of servants. For on this account our Jesus himself said to one who often called him Lord, but did none of the things which he prescribed, Why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? For it is not saying that will profit anyone, but doing. By all means, therefore, is there need of good works. Moreover, if anyone has been thought worthy to recognize both as teaching one doctrine, that man has been counted rich in God, understanding both the old things as new in time, and the new things as old. Chapter 8. A large congregation. While Peter was thus speaking, the multitudes, as if they had been called by someone, entered into the place where Peter was. Then he, seeing a great multitude, like the smooth current of a river gently flowing towards him, said to Maroons, Have you any place here that is better able to contain the crowd? Then Maroons conducted him to a garden plot in the open air, and the multitudes followed. But Peter, standing upon a base of a statue which was not very high, as soon as he had saluted the multitude in pious fashion, knowing that many of the crowd that stood by were tormented with demons and many sufferings of long standing, and hearing them shrieking with lamentation, and falling down before him in supplication, rebuked them, and commanded them to hold their peace, and promising healing to them after the discourse, began to speak on this wise. Chapter 9. Vindicate the ways of God to men. While beginning to discourse on the worship of God to those who are altogether ignorant of everything, and whose minds have been corrupted by the accusations of our adversary Simon, I have thought it necessary first of all to speak of the blamelessness of the God who hath made all things, starting from the occasion seasonably afforded by him according to his providence, that it may be known how with good reason many are held by many demons, and subjected to strange sufferings, that in this the justice of God may appear, and that those who through ignorance blame him, now may learn by good speaking and well doing what sentiments they ought to hold, and recall themselves from their previous accusation, assigning ignorance as the cause of their evil presumption, in order that they may be pardoned. Chapter 10. The Original Law. But thus the matter stands. The only good God having made all things well, and having handed them over to man, who was made after his image, he who had been made breathing of the divinity of him who made him, being a true prophet and knowing all things, for the honor of the Father who had given all things to him, and for the salvation of the sons born of him, as a genuine father preserving his affection towards the children born of him, and wishing them, for their advantage, to love God and be loved of him, showed them the way which leads to his friendship, teaching them by what deeds of men the one God and Lord of all is pleased, and having exhibited to them the things that are pleasing to him, appointed a perpetual law to all, which neither can be abrogated by enemies, nor is vitiated by any impious one, nor is concealed in any place, but which can be read by all. To them, therefore, by obedience to the law, all things were in abundance, the fairest of fruits, fullness of years, freedom from grief and from disease, bestowed upon them without fear, with all salubrity of the air. Chapter 11. Cause of the fall of man. But they, because they had at first no experience of evils, being insensible to the gift of good things, were turned to ingratitude by abundance of food and luxuries, so that they even thought that there is no providence, since they had not by previous labor got good things as the reward of righteousness, inasmuch as no one of them had fallen into any suffering or disease, or any other necessity, so that, as is usual for men afflicted on account of wicked transgression, they should look about for the God who is able to heal them. But immediately after their despite, which proceeded from fearlessness and secure luxury, a certain just punishment met them, as following from a certain arranged harmony, removing from them good things as having hurt them, and introducing evil things instead, as advantageous. Chapter 12. Metamorphoses of the Angels. For of the spirits who inhabit the heaven, the angels who dwell in the lowest region, being grieved at the ingratitude of men to God, asked that they might come into the life of men, that, really becoming men, by more intercourse they might convict those who had acted ungratefully towards him, and might subject every one to adequate punishment. When, therefore, their petition was granted, they metamorphosed themselves into every nature, for, being of a more godlike substance, they are able easily to assume any form. So they became precious stones, and goodly pearl, and the most beauteous purple, and choice gold, and all matter that is held in most esteem. And they fell into the hands of some, and into the bosoms of others, and suffered themselves to be stolen by them. They also changed themselves into beasts and reptiles, and fishes, and birds, and into whatsoever they pleased. These things also the poets among yourselves, by reason of fearlessness, sing, as they befell, attributing to one the many and diverse doings of all. Chapter 13. The Fall of the Angels. But when, having assumed these forms, they convicted as covetous those who stole them, and changed themselves into the nature of men, in order that, living holily, and showing the possibility of so living, they might subject the ungrateful to punishment, yet having become in all respects men, they also partook of human lust, and being brought under its subjection they fell into cohabitation with women, and being involved with them, and sunk in defilement and altogether emptied of their first power, were unable to turn back to the first purity of their proper nature, their members turned away from their fiery substance, for the fire itself, being extinguished by the weight of lust, and changed into flesh, they trod the impious path downward. For they themselves, being fettered with the bonds of flesh, were constrained and strongly bound, wherefore they have no more been able to ascend into the heavens. Chapter 14. Their discoveries. For after the intercourse, being asked to show what they were before, and being no longer able to do so, on account of their being unable to do anything else after their defilement, yet wishing to please their mistresses, instead of themselves, they showed the bowels of the earth, I mean, the choice metals, gold, brass, silver, iron, and the like, with all the most precious stones. And along with these charmed stones, they delivered the arts of the things pertaining to each, and imparted the discovery of magic, and taught astronomy, and the powers of roots, and whatever was impossible to be found out by the human mind, also the reeking of gold and silver, and the like, and the various dyeing of garments. And all things, in short, which are for the adornment and delight of women, are the discoveries of these demons bound in flesh. Chapter 15. The Giants. But from their unhallowed intercourse spurious men sprang, rank greater in stature than ordinary men, whom they afterwards call giants, not those dragon-footed giants who waged war against God, as those blasphemous myths of the Greeks do sing, but wild in manners, and greater than men in size, inasmuch as they were sprung of angels, yet less than angels, as they were born of women. Therefore God, knowing that they were barbarized to brutality, and that the world was not sufficient to satisfy them, that they might not through want of food turn, contrary to nature, to the eating of animals, and yet seem to be blameless, as having ventured upon this through necessity, the Almighty God rained manna upon them, suited to their various tastes, and they enjoyed all that they would. But they, on account of their bastard nature, not being pleased with purity of food, longed only after the taste of blood. Wherefore they first tasted flesh. Chapter 16. Cannibalism. And the men who were with them there for the first time were eager to do the like. Thus, although we are born neither good nor bad, we become one or the other, and having formed habits, we are with difficulty drawn from them. But when irrational animals fell short, these bastard men tasted also human flesh. For it was not a long step to the consumption of flesh like their own, having first tasted it in other forms. Chapter 17. The Flood. But by the shedding of much blood, the pure air being defiled with impure vapor, and sickening those who breathed it, rendered them liable to diseases, so that thenceforth men fled prematurely. But the earth being by these means greatly defiled, these first teemed with poison darting and deadly creatures. All things, therefore, going from bad to worse, on account of these brutal demons, God wished to cast them away like an evil leaven, lest each generation from a wicked seed, being like to that before it, and equally impious, should empty the world to come of saved men. And for this purpose, having warned a certain righteous man, with his three sons, together with their wives and their children, to save themselves in an ark, he sent a deluge of water, that all being destroyed, the purified world might be handed over to him who was saved in the ark, in order to a second beginning of life. And thus it came to pass. Chapter 18. The Law to the Survivors. Since, therefore, the souls of the deceased giants were greater than human souls, inasmuch as they also excelled their bodies, they, as being a new race, were called also by a new name. And to those who survived in the world a law was prescribed of God through an angel, how they should live. For being bastards in race, of the fire of angels and the blood of women, and therefore liable to desire a certain race of their own, they were anticipated by a certain righteous law. For a certain angel was sent to them by God, declaring to them his will, and saying. Chapter 19. The Law to the Giants or Demons. These things seem good to the all-seeing God, that you lord it over no man, that you trouble no one, unless anyone of his own accord subject himself to you, worshipping you, and sacrificing and pouring libations, and partaking of your table, or accomplishing anything else that they ought not, or shedding blood, or tasting dead flesh, or filling themselves with that which is torn of beasts, or that which is cut, or that which is strangled, or anything else that is unclean. But those who betake themselves to my law, you not only shall not touch, but shall also do honor to, and shall flee from, their presence. For whatsoever shall please them, being just, respecting you, that you shall be constrained to suffer. But if any of those who worship me go astray, either committing adultery, or practicing magic, or living impurely, or doing any other of the things which are not well pleasing to me, then they will have to suffer something at your hands or those of others, according to my order. But upon them, when they repent, I, judging of their repentance, whether it be worthy of pardon or not, shall give sentence. These things, therefore, ye ought to remember and to do, well knowing that not even your thoughts shall be able to be concealed from him. Chapter 20. Willing captives? Having charged them to this effect, the angel departed. But you are still ignorant of this law, that everyone who worships demons, or sacrifices to them, or partakes with them of their table, shall become subject to them and receive all punishment from them, as being under wicked lords. And you who, on account of ignorance of this law, have been corrupted beside their altars, and have been satiated with food offered to them, have come under their power, and do not know how you have been in every way injured in respect of your bodies. But you ought to know that the demons have no power over anyone, unless first he be their table companion, since not even their chief can do anything contrary to the law imposed upon them by God, wherefore he has no power over anyone who does not worship him, but neither can anyone receive from them any of the things that he wishes, nor in anything be hurt by them, as you may learn from the following statement. Chapter 21. Temptation of Christ. For once the King of the present time came to our King of righteousness, using no violence, for this was not in his power, but inducing and persuading, because the being persuaded lies in the power of everyone. Approaching him, therefore, as being King of things present, he said to the King of things future, "All the kingdoms of the present world are subject to me, also the gold and the silver and all the luxury of this world are under my power. Wherefore fall down and worship me, and I will give you all these things." And this he said, knowing that after he worshipped him he would have power also over him, and thus would rob him of the future glory and kingdom. But he, knowing all things, not only did not worship him, but would not receive anything of the things that were offered by him. For he pledged himself with those that are his, to the effect that it is not lawful henceforth even to touch the things that are given over to him. Therefore he answered and said, "Thou shalt fear the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve." Chapter 22. The Marriage Supper. However, the king of the impious, striving to bring over to his own counsel the king of the pious, and not being able, ceased his efforts, undertaking to persecute him for the remainder of his life. But you, being ignorant of the foreordained law, are under his power through evil deeds. Wherefore you are polluted in body and soul, and in the present life you are tyrannized over by sufferings and demons, but in that which is to come you shall have your souls to be punished. And this not you alone suffer through ignorance, but also some of our nation, who by evil deeds having been brought traitor the power of the prince of wickedness, like persons invited to a supper by a father celebrating the marriage of his son, have not obeyed. But instead of those who through preoccupation disobeyed, the father celebrating the marriage of his son, has ordered us, through the prophet of the truth, to come into the partings of the ways, that is, to you, and to invest you with the clean wedding garment, which is baptism, which is for the remission of the sins done by you, and to bring the good to the supper of God by repentance, although at the first they were left out of the banquet. Chapter 23. The Assembly Dismissed. If, Therefore, ye wish to be the vesture of the divine spirit, hasten first to put off your base presumption, which is an unclean spirit and a foul garment. And this you cannot otherwise put off, than by being first baptized in good works. And thus being pure in body and in soul, you shall enjoy the future eternal kingdom. Therefore neither believe in idols, nor partake with them of the impure table, nor commit murder, nor adultery, nor hate those whom it is not right to hate, nor steal, nor set upon any evil deeds, since, being deprived of the hope of future blessings in the present life, you shall be subjected to evil demons and terrible sufferings, and in the world to come you shall be punished with eternal fire. Now, then, what has been said is enough for today. For the rest, those of you who are afflicted with ailments remain for healing, and of the others, you who please go in peace. Chapter 24. The sick healed. When he had thus spoken, all of them remained, some in order to be healed, and others to see those who obtained cures. But Peter, only laying his hands upon them, and praying, healed them, so that those who were straightway cured were exceeding glad, and those who looked on exceedingly wondered, and blessed God, and believed with a firm hope, and with those who had been healed departed to their own homes, having received a charge to meet early on the following day. And when they had gone, Peter remained there with his associates, and partook of food, and refreshed himself with sleep.